In our first session here this morning, we're going to be continuing on in Romans chapter 8. And then during our second session, we're going to have a time of review. We'll partake in the Lord's table and then have a time of question and answer. And so that's kind of the agenda for this morning. Again, we're talking about suffering with Christ, that we might be also glorified together. And we're talking about the first kind of sufferings that we're going to experience, the sufferings of this present time, that which is common and natural to man. And Paul has been going through that, not only in connection with what they are, but how we are to reckon that they're not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. And he's been going into now that glory that shall be revealed in us. And he's been, in connection with that, discussing the creature. And we've defined what the creature is, not only the heavenly realm, but the life and the wisdom that the heavenly realm is supposed to have. And in connection with that, we've taken a look at the mystery aspect of this epistle here in Romans chapter 8, which really comes to the forefront now. What Paul's been dealing with in verses 1 through 8, chapters 1 through 8 up to this point, has really been mostly the spiritual things in the New Testament. The fact that we get those things ministered to us by the Apostle Paul is part of the mystery, but the content, again, are things that we can go back and search out, and Paul has a special apostleship in revealing them to us, not just progressively revealing them in the Old Testament, but he gets this privilege of making them manifest and making them fully known. However, there's a different dynamic now that takes place in Romans 8 in connection with the creature and its deliverance from the bondage of corruption, because that had not been made known in time past. And therefore, Paul really gets underway here, the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. What the preaching of Christ does for us, this dispensation of God's grace, is in accordance with the revelation of the mystery, and that has to do with our God's plan and purpose, his calling for us. His calling for us is to be the new creature which will displace and replace the creature that's currently up there, that is, especially those that are running the creature up there, the devil and his angels, and they are subject to vanity. The rest of the holy angels are subject to that vanity, not willingly, but however, God subjected the creature in hope. He wants to change its current state and condition of vanity. And its current state and condition that it is in the bondage of corruption, but he wants to deliver it. And so in talking about all this, the creature and its hope and what it is, and it will be delivered by us when we're manifest, what Paul is doing, what God, our Heavenly Father, is doing, what the Spirit is leading us in, is to get some detail regarding our hope. Get some detail regarding our God's plan and purpose with us in the life that is to come. Detail about glory. Again, oftentimes we relate glory and our hope, and it is part of it, so don't take it too far, and I don't mean to take it too far. But we think about eternal life, and we think about our resurrected body. And in fact, when we go down through this, when we actually first talk about that in verse 23, I want you to completely think about the resurrected body completely differently than you might have been taught it, because the very first time in which Paul brings up the redemption of our body and the fact that we will get a new body is in this context. It's not just the context that we will be resurrected, but we will be resurrected unto God's purpose that he has for us. And it is in connection with that purpose that Paul, that our Father, that the Spirit wants to think about our resurrected body, to utilize that body to serve in connection with his business that he has for us. It's not that what you've maybe thought about the resurrected body isn't true, but I want us to be able to think about it in the context in which he teaches it to us here. And so in connection with talking about our hope, our glory, and all these things, he's giving us detail about our purpose. He's giving us detail about, again, that glory, the creature to be able to utilize these things now. Even though these things are expressing to us and describing to us something that's yet future, they have application and ramification and implication now. In fact, we know that from verse 18. He says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Even though we're not supposed to compare the glory to the sufferings of this present time, the only point in time in which you could come along and give an expression such as that is when you're in the present time, when suffering still does exist. That's not something you're going to be doing when you're in glory. You won't necessarily be comparing the sufferings that you had before to that glory. No, you're going to be experiencing that glory. And I just point that out to show you that that verse, Paul's reckoning that now. He has the future hope and glory in view, and he's bringing that to bear on his mind in the sufferings of this present time. And as he's really experiencing the sufferings of this present time, and we're going to eventually see there in verse 22, "For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain," together until now, when he's in pain, what he's utilizing to bring to mind and reckon greater than the pain that he's going through, whether it's emotionally, whether it's physically, whatever it may be, that he's thinking about this hope, that he's thinking about this glory, that he's putting that on the forefront of his mind, that he's letting that hold sway. It's his mind stay. He's reckoning it. He's counting it true. The deliverance of a new body, the deliverance of the creature, and the culmination of all these things that come to a head at that point in time, he's letting that influence his mind to this point where he's in pain, he's going through the sufferings of this present time, and he says, "The things that I'm experiencing now are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in him." And what that's doing is that's not taking away the pain. It's not taking away the sufferings. What it's doing is it's enabling, it's empowering that with the pain and in the suffering, that they aren't affecting us to the point in which we become faint, to the point where we're no longer walking. The whole point in Romans 8 is walking after the Spirit. And having this walk be from the point in which you learn it until the end of your life. And that utilizing that time to be edified and glorify God. Knowing that that's going to work for you a reward in the life that is to come. And what God is doing is he has provided for everything. In other words, that there is nothing that you can experience that can get you away from this walk if you operate upon his provision. And sufferings are designed to have us faint. They're designed for us to back out, to be crippled by the effects of the pain and the suffering instead of being able to be empowered, have life in the suffering, have life in the pain, to be able to continue to walk and to do things that are pleasing and glorifying to God and are beneficial for us in the life that is to come. And so there is no situation and circumstance that you could ever be in, because that's the context he's bringing it up in, the sufferings of this present time, that you can't have work for you good. In fact, that's where we're headed. If you look at verse 28, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose." You can have all things work together for good. And we'll have to define what that good is and those kind of things. It doesn't say all things work together as they should, or as you would want them to work out. But they work out together for good because you have a different set of eyes. You have a different way of understanding things and a different perception. You have the Father's perspective. And when you have the Father's perspective, things can be so bad, but you have the light of his word. You have the power of his word that gives you his mind in that situation and circumstance to carry out his will and that will work for you good glory in the life that is to come. But again, that's the nature and the kind of this information. That's what it's designed to do. I've said it before and I'll keep saying it. One of the things, especially as we've taken 4 or 5 years in the book of Romans, some of the, not necessarily from you all, but from folks via email and those kind of things, is church doesn't seem too practical. And I said, well, the information that we're dealing with currently isn't so practical. We've talked about the issue of being an ambassador and sharing the gospel and being educated to do that in Romans 1, 2, and 3. But up until this point, it hasn't been too practical. Romans 6, we got a little bit. But we've been learning that the forgiveness of our sin and the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, and that the righteousness of God being imputed to us by faith and faith alone, and the much more love of God, so that we know that we can never lose our salvation. We can never become disjustified. In Romans 6, we learned about our new identity, dead to sin, dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God. And that all took place the moment that we were saved. And it wasn't until Romans 6, verse 12 there, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that it began to get a little bit more practical. But the information isn't necessarily dictating to us practicality. It's educating us about what God did the moment we were saved to establish us. It wasn't until really Romans chapter 8 where we begin to learn about this walk, the positive side of the walk. The negative side is you don't walk after the flesh. Don't put yourself under the law. Walk after the Spirit. This is how you do it, and those kind of things. And now we've gotten to this point where it's becoming all practical. You know the sufferings you go through. You know the natural sufferings that are common to man that you can experience in a loved one who doesn't believe in the gospel, that they experience. Those sufferings are common to man. Those things are happening a lot these days, and most likely a lot in your life. So think about all the instances and the times that those sufferings come to your mind, and the pain that you feel, and the emotional turmoil that it can be, all those times that you now, in those moments, in those situations and circumstances, you can reckon that they're not worthy to be compared with the glory that should be revealed in you. Now you're busy. Now you're walking. Now you're taking His information that you learned, and now you're walking it out. Here it's just mostly taking place in the mind, but that's where our walk first and foremost takes place. They that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Walking after the Spirit is by what's going on in the mind, is what's going on in the mind, the things that the Spirit would have going on in your mind. And so it becomes very practical now. Every situation, circumstance that you're in connection with suffering, you can reckon that are not worthy to be compared to glory that shall be revealed in you. And now we have some meat to that bone. We understand a little bit about what that glory is. That glory is in connection with delivering this the creature from the bondage of corruption. We know that the creature is made up of the holy angels and devil and his angels. And the holy angels were subject to this vanity, not willingly. They're in pain. They're suffering under the vanity of the devil and his angels, and the vanity that they're bringing to that realm. And they don't come along and get to this point where they're so distraught that they question God's hope and God's plan and purpose, and to the point where they're no longer earnestly expecting. Their mind is ever, we can't wait until our state and condition changes. And what that does is it, again, it provides for that hope. And they're thinking about that hope. God is long-suffering today. Christ is suffering. We're suffering with Him. And so we're not in this alone. The creature is, the Father is, the Spirit, the Son is, and the Spirit, by virtue of what He's teaching to us, He too understands the issue of suffering. And each one of those, the Father, the Son, the Spirit, and the creature, and we're going to learn another one, the whole creation, the rest of creation. How they deal with the suffering is by thinking about the life that is to come, the glory that is to come. And what does that do? It gets them through. It not only gets them through, but it enables them to do some things. Again, just imagine if God instituted this dispensation of God's of His grace. He raised up the Apostle Paul, sent him out with a message, and he started to show forth all long-suffering, and he said, that's enough. You know, one day he's going to do that, but it's in connection with when the fullness comes. And we'll talk about that later on down the line. But he doesn't say, I can't deal with this suffering anymore. I can't deal with this suffering anymore. And 10 years in, he stops it. You and I wouldn't even be born. You and I wouldn't even be saved. And what propels him to keep it going is his plan and purpose, the glory in the life that is to come. That's the manner in which he can long suffer to the point that he has now. And what that allows him to do is to not, and he doesn't come along and say, okay, I can't take the suffering anymore, and we're going to halt all operations. I'm going to let the dispensation of grace go on, but I'm going to halt every other operation. In other words, I'm not going to have the ambassador share the gospel anymore. I'm not going to have local assemblies function as the pillar and ground of the truth. Things just go on. He doesn't do that. Rather, his long-suffering and thinking about the glory allows him not just to be content and say, okay, well, I can get through this. It propels him to keep going on, keep doing things, because they're going to amount to more and more glory. And so the same is true for us, is that when we know about the glory, when we know about our hope, it has application now for us not to faint, and not only not to faint, but to continue to walk. To continue to walk. In fact, eventually we're gonna run. And to run through this time of present time sufferings. That doesn't mean you're not gonna suffer. It just means that you're gonna be able to bear and handle and the sufferings and not let them negatively affect you to the way in which they can. You're gonna be operating upon something greater. So let's add to this a little bit more here. Again, we've already talked about in verse 20, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. The creature, the aspect of the creature here that's really in view is the aspect that, the part that earnestly expects. The holy angels are the aspect of the creature that earnestly expect the manifestation of the sons of God. The devil and his angels don't earnestly expect because we're the ones that are going to take their positions. They don't want that to take place. In fact, when we get down, we're going to learn in verse 35 that he wants us to separate us from that process, to halt that process. For that process not to take place, to separate us from the love of Christ. And so that's who's in view here. Verse 20, the holy angels, they were subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same and hope. God not only subjected that realm, that creature, to vanity, it was not going to be able to fulfill God's plan and purpose with it. However, at the same time, in the same realm, he subjected it to hope. He has a future plan for it. And what is that? Verse 21. Because the creature itself also. And that expression, because, which is the cause, which is to be explained in the next proposition, which is the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. He's subject to the same in hope, and how he's going to fulfill that hope is he's going to deliver it. And what you have now is you have two concepts. You have two concepts laid out for us. The first was the issue of the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. And now you have the issue of the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of the corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. The manifestation of the sons of God lines up with the glorious liberty of the children of God. And what that's going to do is it's going to deliver the creature from its vanity. It's going to deliver the creature from the bondage of corruption. And all the pain and all the suffering and all the devolution and all the corruption and all the selfishness and all the pride and all the boasting and all the railing and accusations and everything else that's taking place up there and all the fighting and the backbiting that goes on up there will come to an end. By us. And we have to get this point. Yes, God does deal with no longer having backbiting by going on just by eradicating sin out of our bodies and giving us a new body. But he doesn't want it just to be that. He wants us to stop that now. To gain his life now. And we're able to have his life now to restrain those things and not just be it by virtue of having a new body that doesn't have sin in it. That something is taking place in our mind. We can experience that life now by walking after the Spirit. And so the manifestation of the sons of God and the glorious liberty of the children of God are the means by which the creature is going to be delivered from the bondage of corruption. Now, I want to briefly just talk there in verse 21 when it says the creature itself also. One, the itself is its own self-identification. Itself, it's distinct from something else. However, also, it has a common feature to it with something else. And that's going to come out of verse 22 when he further explains and amplifies what he means here. He says, for we know that the whole creation groaneth in travail and pain together until now. The whole creation is under the bondage of corruption. The whole creation is subject to vanity. It took place in two phases in connection with Satan's plan of evil. It first took place in the heavenly places when he trafficked his iniquity in the sanctuaries in the heavenly places, and God subject that realm to vanity. And then when he made man on the earth and he came in and dealt with man, he usurped dominion from the earth, the bondage of corruption took place on this earth. And the whole creation is subject to the bondage of corruption. And the whole creation is going to be delivered from the bondage of corruption. And how this all plays out is he's going to deliver the creature first, and then he'll deliver the earth. The very same order in which it was usurped is the very same order in which God will get it back. And that's one of the reasons why it's in the order in which it is. That's also one of the reasons why you have Romans 8 before you get to Romans 9, 10, 11, and you learn about Israel's fullness. Is because first we will have our fullness, then Israel will have their fullness. Order is so important. And you get God's mind in connection with these things in regards to how he's going to carry things out. And so you have that. But the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption. The earth and the realm in which we live now will be delivered. But the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption. Briefly, delivered is, again, to set free, to liberate, to relieve, to save, to rid, divest, clear out, to disburden and unburden, to give entirely over, to surrender, to yield, to hand over, transfer, commit to another's possession or keeping. Deliver is the most general term. The critical shade of meaning of deliver is that it is a term that is reserved for describing the idea of taking something or someone from danger. We deliver when we take from the evil that is. There's danger up there right now. There's vanity. There's corruption. There's death. And it needs to be delivered. And God subjected that creature to hope. Knowing that it was going to be delivered from the evil and the danger and everything that's taking place up there. The you kind of also have an idea of childbirth. Remember we talked about this pain and the issue of being devolution, things getting worse and worse? Well, that takes place in childbirth. In fact, the same kind of description is what's going to take place out here. You have the beginning of sorrows, and this day will be as a woman in travail, and it's just going to get intensified, the pain and the travail of a woman giving birth to a child. It's slow at first, it's not as painful at first, and then it just intensifies. And what happens at the end? There's what? Liberty. I remember especially with Abigail, because I think Michelle was in labor for 34 hours. Josiah was like 3 or something like that. But I remember with Abigail, just took a long time, and it just got worse and worse, and I'm just like, oh my goodness, I don't even know what to think. And I just thought about Romans 8, and I just kept telling her, there's liberty, there's freedom at the end, you know, just keep going. And that's easy for me to say, but that's the reality, and that's what needs to take place. And she talked about how it is, it's thinking about that child, being able to see the child that's been in your womb that you felt. It's that issue of that glory that's revealed in us. It's in her. And she can feel it, and she's feeding it, and it's growing, and it's maturing, and only to the capacity that it can. And there's the childbirth, the pain of the child coming and coming out, and the issue of the intensifying, and then there's liberty, and it just essentially changed. Just like that. It was just phenomenal. I just couldn't believe it, how she can go from one moment of being so in pain to the other moment where she's crying and she's in the state of jubilation and emotion, of freedom from the pain, of a refreshing. And she's got her child right there. Glory. That's what's being described, that in this life, the things that we go through and the intensification of it and how it's going to get worse and worse is going to happen that way. And what he's doing is he's dangling the carrot of the glory ahead of us to think about that, because it's going to be worth it. And you know what? It wasn't so bad because we had another one. And you'd think after that 34 hours, maybe you're ready to do this again. And you forget about the pain because you enjoy the glory so much. And that's the idea. Is you start thinking about the glory. The difference with childbirth is there's actual sensations and feelings and tangible holding. Right now, all that we have in regards to that glory is the words of God's word and the eyes of our understanding. That's why we have to reckon it to be true, no matter what we experience. And the issue is it's going to be worth it all? We're just saying it. Just one glimpse of him in glory will some of the toils of life repay. Is that what it says? All the toils of life will repay. Not only will it repay, it will be greater. And so what he's doing is he's describing to us how he deals with suffering now, is thinking about the glory, and it consumes him. It consumes him to the point where he keeps doing what he's doing, and it doesn't affect him the way that it naturally can affect us. And we have that privilege of thinking that as well. Now, I want to briefly go through some things, because it says the creature itself also. I want to just highlight just a couple passages in connection with the earth's deliverance from the bondage of corruption, some of the things that it will entail. Come with me to Isaiah chapter 11. I'm just going to look at a few things here. Isaiah chapter 11. We can start all the way at chapter 1, or verse 1, I'm sorry. Look at verse 1, Isaiah 11, verse 1. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. It's talking about Christ here. and shall make of him quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. So there's going to be wrath there in verse 4, and then there's going to be righteousness and glory. And look at some of this, verse 6. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf, and the young lion, and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. And the cow and the bear shall feed. Their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The sucking child shall play on the hole of the asp, that's the serpent. And the weaned child shall put his hand on the cockatrice den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. The bondage of corruption that our earth experiences is part of that is in connection with the animals. When God made Adam to have dominion over the earth, it was also over the fowls of the air, the beasts of the field, and every creeping thing that creepeth. And here you have the issue of those beasts of the field. You can't even imagine what the animals are for and God's utilization of them. You go over to Job and you read some things about what true dominion over the animal kingdom is to be able to take that unicorn, which my understanding is the rhino, and it be the rhino. You are able to command the rhino to till your fields, and it obey you. That's not what's going on today. And God has put certain things in the animal kingdom, in the animals, and you can see them now in some form or measure, but they all have unique purpose, and dominion over them is to be able to utilize them for the sake of the earth and those kind of things, and what God's plan and purpose is with man. And then that's gonna change. And the cow and the bear shall feed together. The wolf with the lamb. And there was no longer gonna be the prey and predator type system that's going on. So that's part of the deliverance from the bondage of corruption for this earth. Look at Isaiah 65, verse 17. Isaiah 65, verse 17. Isaiah 65, and verse 17. It says, "For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered nor come into my mind." He's going to create new heavens and a new earth. And by what he means here is the how we see them right now. There's going to be a new heavens. He says there, we're not going to go through all of them. Revelation 6, verse 14, the heavens departed as a scroll. Throughout this process, Isaiah 34, verse 4, the host of heaven falls, the stars fall to the earth. Which, by the way, helps you understand the heavens a little bit more than what you're taught in school. Because if you think about how it's taught in school, how do the stars fall to the earth? When it's just a whole bunch of space out there. And you can have this star going that way and that star going this way. No, they're gonna fall to the earth. There's a lot more science in the scriptures than we give the scriptures credit for, but they're going to fall to the earth. Look at Revelation 7. Revelation 7.
Stars are literal versus like the angelical.
Those are, well, it's both. It's both. You'll find passages in scriptures that are both the angelic realm, the devil and his angels fall they're identified as stars, but you also have actual stars. You see that in Job, the constellations that he uses, Pleiades and Orion and Arcturus. So those are little stars that are going to be utilized out there, and they're going to fall. Look at Revelation 7, look at verse 17. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, it's talking about they're in the kingdom, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away all, what? Tears from their eyes. Deliverance from the bondage of corruption, it's all its ramification, all its impact that it's made. Look at one more, Revelation 21. Look at Revelation 21, and start here in verse 1. Revelation 21, verse 1, and I saw a new heaven and new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. That's when he'll fulfill his name, Emmanuel. Verse 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more, what?
Death,
neither what?
Sorrow.
Remember what he called, well, when we first dealt with this issue of suffering, sufferings at this present time, we went all the way back to Genesis, and in what shall she bear children? In sorrow. And what will the man do in connection with the ground? To the ground. In sorrow. That's a term to denote suffering. And death, we know from Romans 5 that sin entered the world, and death by sin, and corruption, and sorrow, and crying. And then he says, neither shall there be any more, what? Pain. No more pain. Can you imagine that? I hope so. Because that's part of the glory. No more pain. Pain, an uneasy sensation in bodies of any degree, from slight uneasiness to extreme distress or torture, proceeding from pressure, tension, or spasms, separation of parts by violence, or any derangement of functions. Uneasiness of mind, disquietude, anxiety, solicitude for the future, grief, sorrow for the past. No more pain. No more pain. And that's not only going to take place in connection with the kingdom, but that's going to take place in connection with the creature as well, and us up there. He says, for the former things are passed away. One day, the things that we experience will be former. They'll be former. And that's how we have to think about them. Look at as we go back over to Romans 8, come with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm sorry, chapter 4. A little different context, but principles the same, especially as we look at verse 18. But look at 2 Corinthians 4, look at verse 17. 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 17. He says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment. You only can say that when you have an eternal perspective. When the things you go through now will be former. When the things you go through now, as you go down through eternity, will be but for a moment. Worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Isn't that a great... God can take something, change your perspective of something that you're going through now, and then come along and you look at it from an eternal perspective, and that this time that we go through, this life, is but a moment. But this moment can work eternal glory. We're going to eventually look at the word glory. When we talk about the word glory, one of the definitions of glory is something of a great undertaking. When something's glorious, you've gone to great lengths and labor, and you partook in a great undertaking. When I think of something, a great undertaking, I don't necessarily think of a moment in time. And God's able to take that great moment because of what he's doing, because of what's going on in time and in that moment, and because of who he is, that's a great undertaking. And he's able to take that moment and that brief amount of time, this present time that we're in our life, and he's able to turn that thing into eternal glory. Endless time. And glory in that endless time. That's the transaction that he's talking about. This is another. We talk about the great transaction, right? That God, who became sin for us, who knew no sin, but became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now we're talking about going through suffering in this life, however many years you may have. And he doesn't qualify it. He doesn't say, okay, you have to be 20 when you start this. The issue is the quality of what you have, his word, and once you have it and utilize it, and he's able to take that present time suffering, able to take the things that you go through in this brief moment of life that we have and turn it into eternal glory. There's no one else that can do that. That's what we're a part of. That's the grandeur of this. That's what ought to excite you when you get up in the morning. Is that I'm going to go through this day, which is a fraction of a moment in time, and I can utilize this fraction of a moment in time to work eternal glory. God through me. That's how you start looking at time. That's why he's going to say in Ephesians that we are to redeem the time. Utilize it. Buy it. Take the time that once was in vain and now utilize it, because before it just worked death. It just worked corruption. It just worked vanity. There was no profit, no value. You couldn't turn that fraction of a moment into. You looked at time in the sense that you had all the time in the world and you're going to waste a whole bunch of time, and that was your pleasure and that was your enjoyment. That was your goal, and to get as much money as you could. I'm not saying you did this before, but that's how the world thinks. Get as much money as you could. Climb the corporate ladder. Become a authority in whatever realm in which you're in, and look at all this, and then you die and it's nothing. And you leave a legacy that you can't enjoy because you're dead. For other people just to follow after and follow the same vanity cycle, which is what Ecclesiastes is all about. Vanity of vanities. But now you and I are in Christ. And time is completely different. Because it's not vanity that we're going after. We labor because we know that our labor, we work because we know that our labor is not in vain in the Lord. As long as we're doing it in the Lord, as long as we're walking after the Spirit, and we're minding his things, and we're doing things in connection with what the Word of God teaches us, now we can redeem the time. We can take this fraction of this moment that we live in, and it work for eternal glory. That's a great transfer. There's no better investment that you could ever invest your life in than that. The calling and the things that we're a part of transcends everything that we could ever experience on this earth and everything that we could ever do on this earth. Folks, this is all leading. This is why I get excited about this, and I'm trying to show that, and I'm trying to go through this and talk about it at different angles and do all this, is because by the time we get to the end of this chapter, we have to be, verse 38, we have to be persuaded. We need to be thrilled. And however you show that, whether you show it or whatever it may be, but you gotta be thrilled. You're gonna want to go after the Spirit. That's where he wants us to get us to. We're not doing this out of obligation. We're not doing this out of being a slave. We're not doing this out of we're not doing this grudgingly, even in one sense out of necessity, in connection with how you could look at doing this out of need. You want to do this. You want to walk after the Spirit because you know what you're involved in. You know who you're involved in it with. You know that what it can amount to. But all of that is predicated upon viewing this with the eyes of your understanding. Because if you don't have these eyes, if you don't have them developed, then it's going to be very easy for the world and its wisdom to utilize the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life to creep in and start separating you from what you're supposed to be going after. And you begin to be those that swerve instead of keep walking and running after what he's teaching us. And so all these things are designed and are to amount to the issue of being persuaded that not only are we thrilled with maybe a immature enthusiasm to walk after the Spirit, but eventually a humble, grave excitement to walk after the Spirit by the time we get done with Romans 8. Knowing the glory, knowing what's to come, knowing that he's provided everything from this point on for us to be able to succeed. If God can be for us, who can be against us? That's what he's going to get to. Those questions are in response to what we're learning right now. If God's for us in doing all this, and he's provided everything for us, and he's laid up for us all things to us freely, then the issue is who can be against us? But you got to be persuaded of that. Because when suffering comes in, and the adversary and his enemies and his cohorts utilizing the children of disobedience against you and those kind of things, and it begins to get tough, it's not going to be as easy. And so we need to have that dichotomy in us of having that thrill and excitement, but also know that it's going to get tough. But yet we're still going to want it because we're looking at something greater than the pain, something greater than the suffering. We're looking at the glory. We're looking at the hope. He says in verse 18, it works for us a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory while. So there's a transaction going on, and the working for us glory is predicated and conditioned upon while something takes place. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. We have a different set of eyes, a different looking than the world. And while we look not at those things that are seen, but those things that are eternal, while we walk after the things of the Spirit that are, in one sense, in their origin, intangible, the fruit of the Spirit, while we walk after those things and begin to bear that fruit and those kind of things, they begin to work for us beyond what we already have in Christ. They begin to work for us eternal weight of glory, a weight of glory. And that weight of glory is going to be manifest in your new body. Well, look back at Romans 8. So verse 21, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption. We looked at some of that bondage of corruption in connection with the earth and its deliverance. The most that we experience, we not only experience the bondage of corruption on this earth, but we have sin in our bodies. It works in our bodies. They're not only mortal bodies, but they decay. They're corrupt. You get older, more frail you get, the more the systems begin to shut down and those kind of things. And that's because of sin. And we will be delivered from that as well. And that's part and parcel of this. But he says, deliver from the bondage corruption. I've got my notes here mixed up. Bondage, being subjected to some bond or binding power and influence. And the influence here is corruption. Corruption is the perversion of anything from an original state of purity. A perversion, destruction or spoiling of something, the breaking up or decomposition of something, the destruction or fragmenting of the constitution which makes a thing what it is. And that's what took place when he trafficked his iniquity in the sanctuaries and the heavenly places. That's what took place when sin entered the world and death by sin, is that there was a perversion now in the earth. There's a perversion now in the heavenly places. There's a decay. There's a corruption going on. There's a breaking up or a breaking down, however you want to look at it. There's a deterioration going on. And the earth and the heavenly places are subjected to that negative influence. That's what we see all around us. That's what we experience on a daily basis. And what we have, not after the flesh, but after the Spirit, is we have a godly influence. And we are to be influenced by it, and we are supposed to benefit from that influence and be able to influence other things and then bring that influence to the creature. And that's where the liberty comes in. That's where the liberty comes in, the glorious liberty. You have the issue of into. It's the idea of turning over the influence of that realm to the ones who will liberate it. He's going to come along and say, okay, sons of God. Okay, you children of God. It's yours now. This was once influenced by the former things that are now passed away. This was once influenced by the old creature in its perverted state. But you were involved in some things while you were down there on the earth for the sake of being where we're at this point. Here you go. And he's going to liberate it. Glorious. Glorious are events where someone is impelled, driven, galvanized, roused, motivated to extraordinary efforts and to great undertakings. Liberty is not freedom per se, because liberty has the connotation to it that at one time it was in a condition of captivity, slavery, or bondage. You have this issue of, I was born free. We can be born free, but then if you're in a captivity, Abraham per se was, Jacob, go down a little bit further, Joseph, born free in a sense, but then he was in captivity, and the nation was in captivity. But then when they were delivered from that, they were not necessarily only free, but they were liberated because they were in a state of captivity. And that's what liberty is denoting here, is that the vanity and the bondage of corruption that the creature is in now will be liberated. It will be liberated into the glorious liberty of the children of God. The usage of the children of God here is a little different than there in verse 19, for the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. And my understanding of that is, one, the creature is going to be totally, entirely, and completely liberated. There will not be one aspect of the creature that will not be liberated. And it's going to take every child of God, every justified individual, to do that. Now, is every child of God a son of God? Yes, but there's a distinction here that he's making. And I think that's also in connection with what verse 19 is. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. The manifestation of the sons of God is not just the issue of having redeemed the body, but the product that comes out of the judgment seat of Christ. And we'll develop this more as we go on. I'm kind of giving it to you right now. We're all going to have a new body. Then we're going to go to the resurrection, at the rapture. Then we're going to go to the judgment seat of Christ. And then there's the manifestation of the sons of God. And there's going to be a manifestation. And the creature earnestly expects that. One, in connection with its entire and total deliverance. But when you begin, and this is something that comes later, but I'm giving it to you now, is that you understand the structure of authority, the government that's up there, the principalities, powers, mights, thrones, dominions, and then every other name that is named. And the creature, the holy angels, that aren't even necessarily in one of those positions of authority, are earnestly expecting when the sons of God are fit and qualified and manifest to be in one of those positions. And so you have a twofold dynamic here in connection with its hope is not only for the entire creature to be delivered from the devil and every one of his angels, but also some of those angels are in positions of authority that are really, they're the ones in authority, they're the ones directing and guiding that realm in its corruption. And the holy angels understand how this thing, at least somewhat, is designed to work. And it's not supposed to be filled with corruption, it's not supposed to be filled with ungodliness, but rather with godliness, and that's where you and I come in. And we're going to be, some sons will be manifest to be in those positions of authority, those that are walking after the Spirit, those that are being edified, those that are being educated in God's wisdom and those kind of things, and proving it in the details of their life, that all will be given, will give an account of at the judgment seat of Christ, and then we'll manifest that glory in a new glorious body. And so the creature will be entirely from the top down, as it were, delivered. And every believer in this dispensation of God's grace will participate in the deliverance of the creature from the bondage of corruption. Look at verse 22 real quick. For, he's going to further explain and amplify. For we know that the whole creation, now he says the whole creation. Before he's just talking about the creature, the heavenly realm. Now he's going to bring in the earth, and it's going to be the whole creation. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and faileth in pain together until now. That's a verse that's kind of stuck. It's sandwiched between 21 and 23. Because the point of what he's trying to get at is that the whole creation is groaning and travailing in pain together until now. And until now, the issue is that now we, and not only they, the creature and the earth, but ourselves also. That's been his whole point, is talking about the creature, talking about the glory, talking about the hope, so that we would get to this point that we're responding to the suffering the same exact way that the Father, the Son, the Spirit, and the creature, and now the earth is responding to the pain and suffering that they're going through. And how we respond to it is we reckon that it's not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. And what he's coming along and saying is not only do they groan and travail in pain together until now, but we ourselves also. And he's going to focus on something. He says, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. He's not going to focus so much on travailing. He doesn't say travail in verse 23. But he's going to focus on the groaning. And it's not moaning. Groaning is an expression and a desire for the hope and the glory. And that's been his whole point here, is to get us to that point where we're groaning in the midst of our sufferings for that glory. Not just for it to end. That's part of it, but that's not the truest sense of the groaning. We're not just waiting for it to end. We're waiting for it to be new, for it to be life. And we'll talk about that more as we go forward. But that's where verse 22 is coming in. He says, for we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And the issue is until now, they're groaning, they're travailing in pain. And now verse 23, and not only that, but ourselves also. We're going to join in with their groaning. because we have this hope. We know about this glory now. So that we can truly do what Paul did in verse 18, reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us, and truly do what verse 17 says, suffer with him. Not just suffer the things that he suffers, but respond to the sufferings the way he responds to them. And that is by groaning for the hope and the glory that is to come in the midst of the suffering, to be able to do some things in the meantime. Well, we're going to stop it right there. I'm going to review this a little bit in the second session, review the things that we've been covering here. If this is still, and we still got more to go through, but if this is still a little not clicking, you can definitely blame me, but I want us to be on the same page. I want you to be getting this, because these are the beginning details that we are to perceive. These are the words of understanding that we are to perceive in connection with, one, God's calling with us to in this dispensation of God's grace and what he's doing, our purpose, therefore, and also how this information, again, it's just starting it, but how this information is designed to work in us when we're going through suffering. It's something, Paul says in Philippians, it's a high calling. These things, these thoughts, not that we can't have them, these are high thoughts. These are thoughts that we never thought about before. This is God's purpose with us. And the issue is not that we can't think about them. Eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, neither has entered in the heart of man the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. But he hath revealed to them, to us, the things that he has freely given to us, which are ordained for our glory by his Spirit. The Spirit right here is teaching us the things that are ordained unto our glory. But in one sense, before that, they have not entered into the heart of man. That eye has not seen, nor ear has heard. But we get to see it with the eyes of our understanding. We get to hear it through the reading of God's Word. And it is supposed to, by the Spirit leading us and us studying it, enter into our heart, be written on our heart, so that we truly can reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. And so, again, we have some time, a little bit more time to deal with this, but we need to have this there, because it's going to be it's the start, it's the seed being planted, that information for you to utilize when you go through sufferings. And you now have something to pray and utilize when you're in suffering, and to have capture your mind when you're suffering, and to bring to mind when you're going through pain, is the glory, the creature, its deliverance, what you know about the creature, what you know you can bring to it. And all that's designed to impel you to great undertakings, even in the midst of suffering. To continue on suffering and do things in your suffering. Christ, when he began to suffer on the cross, when he was scourged and he was whipped and to put a crown of thorns in his head, he didn't just stop. He didn't just say, put me to death now. But he took up his cross and he went to Golgotha. And they nailed him to that cross and he finished it out. Why? He endured it. He despised the shame because of the joy that was set before him. He kept going in his suffering. He kept doing what he could in those moments all the way until the end, to the finish, because of a joy that was set before him. And that was to sit at the Father's right hand. And the issue for us is keep going. Not faint, not want just the end, but know that this moment, this fraction of a moment, this suffering. I always thought about if I were in another country, who knows, it could get like this in our country, and you hear some of these stories about people who are just tortured. I mean, just tortured. And I think about the most excruciating torture I could go through and what would be going on in my mind. And obviously the natural thought is I just want it to end. But now I have this. And I don't know if I would think about it in that moment. Only time would tell, and only that situation would tell. But this is a fraction of a moment. Even if it was from 10 years, it's a fraction of a moment compared to eternal glory. And this fraction of a moment, I can utilize it. I can utilize it to magnify Christ in my body, whether it be by life or by death or by suffering. And to utilize it to bring glory to His name, to proclaim the gospel, to proclaim the truth. And it work. And once I'm going to get there, that's just but a moment to truly have that perspective. And if we're supposed to have that perspective in pain and suffering, and most definitely we should have that perspective when we're not going through those things. And to utilize every moment that we have to prove the will of God and to take His things and mind them in our lives. In prayer, that's where I was going. Prayer is the means by which you do that. Prayer is the means to sustain and bring into remembrance and bring to bear the things of the Spirit that you have in you to the forefront of your mind, so that from the forefront of your mind you now do some things in connection with it. It's not so much requesting things, give me this, give me that, one or another, but relating with the Father in connection with the things that He's taught you and say, Father, I'm going to go do these things now. That's what prayer is able to do for you. And when you're in suffering, prayer can be the means by which you bring the glory to your mind and let it begin to influence you the way it's designed and the way it can do. Well, like I said, we'll review in the second session and we'll keep going. And if there's any questions, please ask me. And once we kind of wrap up this section of information, we'll have a Q&A to do that as a group before we go on. We still have a few verses to go, but I just want to make sure that we're on the same page and we're like-minded in these things, and these things are working in you, because once this is in you, there's fruits of it, a peace, a contentment, comfort, a lack of care in regards to worry, because you know the end, you know what's going to take place, and you know that in this time, it can just work for you. And so you begin to look at time, you begin to look at your life differently and a whole host of things. And God's given it to us, and I want all of us to benefit from it. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time to get into your word, to look at these things. All that we've looked at, all the different ways in which we've described it, all the different ways in which we've talked about it. We just thank you for these words, Father. We thank you for our purpose to deliver the creature from the bondage of corruption to the glorious liberty of the children of God. We thank you also that we're your sons of God who are able to walk after the Spirit, and that the creature earnestly expects and waits for the manifestation of the sons of God, for the glory that will be revealed in us. That glory, Father, that will be revealed in us is not anything of our own. It is what you've done in us. And our willingness, and our faith in believing in it, our willingness to participate in it, to mind it, to walk after it, to let it influence us, to acknowledge it in all of our ways, to live by it, and produce your life in us. So may we be willing vessels, and that's where we need to get, at least by Romans 12, that we'd be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto you. It's what you made us to be, and the issue is of our participation in it, walking after it. We give you the thanks and praise, knowing that our walk is connected to this unique purpose with the creature, and that heavenly hope, that glory, can be brought to bear on our minds through the instrumentality of prayer, and therefore in that reckon that what we go through in this present time is but a moment, a fraction of a moment. The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. It transcends, it is higher than the effects and implications of the sufferings that we go through. And may our minds, through prayer, reckon that to be true and hold that hope and that glory in high regard, and let it consume us and give life to our mortal bodies and put on display your mind in the midst of this world, in the midst of suffering, in the midst of pain, that you may be glorified and work for us a far more exceeding eternal way of glory. Father, we do pray if someone's here or listening, if they have not trusted Christ, how they died for their sins, was buried and rose again, that they would believe this very moment. And in the moment they do, they'll be justified unto eternal life. All their sins will be forgiven, past, present, and future. Your righteousness will be imputed unto them, and they'll possess, again, the gift of eternal life. May they believe this very moment. Lastly, we thank you for this time of grace giving. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.